The views and opinions of this broadcast do not reflect the views and opinions of Armed Media, UNU Productions and its affiliates. Enjoy the show.
Good evening and welcome to the Leadership with Biana Kovic Show. And thank you for being with us. Our topic, leadership, focuses on leaders such as yourselves. We believe that leadership is a skill that can be learned through practice and awareness. Throughout the show, we will be talking about leadership traits such as generosity, curiosity, clarity, gratitude, approachability, humility, accountability, and many others, and how they help leaders become more effective when working with individuals, teams, or organizations. We hope that our conversation will help you become more reflective and effective when it comes to your own leadership practices and enable you to leave a positive legacy. Our very special guest is Jake Melton. Jake is an engaging and moving keynote speaker, author, coach, and a leading change and leadership expert. He is a mental health and wellness influencer and a proud voice for Tourette syndrome. Jake has a background in organizational psychology and strategic communications. He has worked closely with CEOs and other high-level executives in organizational development initiatives and consulting projects centered around change management, leadership development, mental health and wellness, and workplace productivity. Jake is author of the book, Minimalize to Maximize Your Happiness, Cut the Crap, and has given hundreds of presentations and has spoken at conferences, conventions, trainings, and other corporate and group events around the country. While Jake loves speaking, writing, bringing awareness to mental health, and inspiring others to simplify their lives, he loves his wife and two children even more. They live in Dallas, Texas. Jake, welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me.
Jake, you're the keynote speaker and a coach, and also the author of Minimalize to Maximize Your Happiness. And I was wondering if you can tell us a little bit more about your book and your leadership and coaching practice.
Sure. So to give you a little bit of context on my book and why I decided to write it and what it has to do with the lives that we're living and leadership and happiness, obviously the title is Minimalize to Maximize Your Happiness. So for me, a little bit of background. I actually have been diagnosed with some mental health illnesses in the past. I was diagnosed with Tourette syndrome when I was 16 years old. I was also diagnosed with depression, anxiety, and at one point in 2014, I was diagnosed with PTSD after my father passed away. So I was, at that time, going to therapy. I was also taking medication regularly to try and kind of mask things that I was going through. And one day I turned on Netflix and I was really into documentaries. And anytime a new one came on, I was excited to watch it. And one came on, it was called Minimalist. So obviously it caught my eye, so I decided to watch it. And after watching it, I realized how well I connected with this minimalism concept and this philosophy of living with what you need and getting rid of things that you don't need. And it really touched me deeper than just our physical atmosphere. So, you know, getting rid of possessions you don't need, focusing more on experience than possessions. For me, I felt it go very deep and cover every single aspect of my life. So, you know, I found there was an emotional and a mental side to minimalism that they didn't talk so much about, but it was just something I interpreted and came out with. And so I decided to start applying it to my life and letting go of relationships that weren't doing me good and were toxic to me or holding me back, and getting rid of things that were wasting my time, letting go of some of the mentalities that I had and cutting some of those out of my life because they weren't doing, you know, me any good and they were holding me back. And so anyways, I decided to do all this, and it made a bigger difference for me, this philosophy of living, than the medication and therapy did. And so fast forward to 2018, I started my speaking coaching business. July 2018, I decided, you know what, I'm going to write a book. I want it to stand out, and I want to apply to business and minimalism. And so I just applied that minimalism, simplicity, essentialism, whatever you want to call it, to every aspect of our life and leadership. And as a leader, it is extremely easy to become overwhelmed. It is easy to focus more on others, which could be detrimental to your own health or your own performance. And so what I've done is crafted a program I call a world-class leader. And I speak and coach on this, but helping leaders elevate their personal and professional development. It goes back to that. If they fill their own cups first, they can then fill the cups of those they lead. Or if they put their oxygen masks on first, they can then put the oxygen mask on those they lead. And so that's kind of my concept, is helping leaders, executives take care of themselves and understand how to do that better in every way possible, mentally, physically, spiritually, emotionally. And that way, once they feel like they're in a positive state in their lives and trying to reach their maximum potential, they can help those they lead do the same exact thing. So those are the programs that I'm offering. And I speak again on leadership, minimalism, mental health. Those are my main topics. And that's what I'm doing today. It's been a wonderful journey. And I've been able to see a lot of change and people out there that I've spoken to or worked with. And it's been an amazing experience.
So thank you so much for talking about minimalism and mindset in particular, because the minimalism that you're talking about, you actually have to change your mindset to let things go, right? Which is very interesting, because we live in a culture that's very consumer focused, buying things, holding on to things, not letting go in particular. So how does one do that?
You know, it takes time. I'll give you an example of my own mom. So my mom had a storage unit that she was paying $200 for. She had it for 4 years. Every time we went to the storage unit, I realized how much stuff there was in there. I mean, they were boxes that had been closed for 10 years. She didn't even know what was in the boxes. My dad passed away in 2014, so she decided to go in. She obviously added more things into it. So one day she was asking me, I need help finding this thing for a party, or I can't remember exactly what it was. I opened up the door to the storage unit, and it was full from top to bottom, front to back. And I looked at her and I said, Mom, there is no way we are going to find that item that you're looking for. I said, why do you have all of this stuff? She's like, I don't know. I just, you know, I need it. And I'm like, you need it. I said, that box hasn't been opened in 10 years and you need it? You don't even know what's in it. So she realized that 90% of what was in that storage unit, she never needed and she didn't really want. So after years of having that, spending over $10,000, you know, trying to keep up that storage unit over the several years, she finally was able to get rid of it. But it took her years to do that. And for some people, they could be really attached. Like for me, the hardest thing for me to let go of were my relationships. There were some friendships or relationships I had for years, and coming to terms with the fact that they weren't going to go forward in my life was extremely painful for me. So that took me a long time too, to kind of sever those relationships. It took months and months for me to be able to prep and do that. So I think being patient, obviously, and understanding it takes time, and then being willing. If you know for a fact you're not going to be willing and you're going to put up a fight with yourself when it comes time to getting rid of anything in your life that you don't need, that's going to hold you back. So you definitely have to be willing to let it go. And I think once it gets to that point, it's just assessing and evaluating whether it's making you happy or whether it's holding you back, and deciding from there what you keep and get rid of.
And thank you so much for mentioning valuation, because that was my next question. How do you evaluate what you should let go and what you hold on to, and in particular when it comes to business?
You know, one of my main phrases I use with people is, in any decision they're making, whether it's, should I keep this item? Should I go this route in business? Should I do this as a leader? Obviously, a lot of science is behind the trust your gut feeling. And I really believe in that. And so my phrase is, any question that you have, if the answer is a 100% yes, then it's a yes. Go for it. If the answer is a 100% no, then it's a no. If the answer is maybe, if you're on the fence, The answer is no. So unless you know for sure and you feel very good about what it is you're going to be doing or letting go of or the direction you're going in, then you need to analyze it differently and figure out why you may feel that way and make sure that you feel 100% about it before going. So that's one of the things I use. And another thing in business, it's really figuring out what's allowing you to remain productive and engaged in the workplace. As a leader, we have that responsibility to make sure those we lead, especially in the workforce, that they feel satisfied in their role. They feel like they're engaged and they're active in what they're doing. And obviously, they're being productive and performing. And so making that evaluation, whether there's distractions that are causing their performance to die down, or maybe they are dealing with mental health issues, or maybe they're not getting enough sleep, whatever it may be, evaluating what it is and then eliminating whatever it is that's holding them back or keeping them from performing or reaching the levels that they hope to achieve.
So how do we evaluate or how do we ask for help when we need that help? Because I think mental health piece is still a little bit, people don't want to talk about it, you know, but it affects our work. It affects our leadership.
It certainly does. You're right. It is still very taboo out there, which is sad. It's sad that it's that way. But the World Health Organization estimates that there's a $1 trillion loss in productivity each year due to anxiety and depression in the workplace. So $1 trillion lost in productivity. It's costing organizations this because their employees are dealing with anxiety or depression. So my advice and my thoughts on this are, as an organization, you need to be aware that 1 in every 5 people are expected to face some sort of mental illness during their life. And 1 in 4 Americans suffer with anxiety in the workplace. So organizations definitely need to take this seriously and provide their employees resources when they need it, whether, you know, it's offsite, whether it's counseling, therapy, whatever it may be, just bringing that support into the culture where they don't necessarily have to go to tell your bosses everything that's going on. You just know that there's a resource available if you need it. And then if it's affecting you past that and your performance is dying and you feel like, you know, you may lose your job and your managers are on your butt about it, then those you can share with them. But as leaders, it's important to recognize when people may be suffering with this. And there's a lot of signs, you know, erratic behavior, any sort of change of behavior. Maybe people have been very engaged in meetings and now they're not at all. They look exhausted. Their performance is dropping. Their productivity is dropping. They're sluggish. There's a lot of different signs out there. And as leaders, it's important for us to recognize those. And if we see it, obviously not confront them and say, hey, I think you have anxiety, or I think you have ADD, or I think you have OCD, or any of these things. It's, hey, I'm here to help. If there's any way I can help you, let me know. If you need to leave a little early, get some sleep, go for it. If you feel like you have too much burden right now, then maybe we could find the capacity on the team to help you out and then go from there. That's my suggestion.
And then also there is a lot of study done that burnout goes hand in hand in post-traumatic stress disorder or some type of anxiety or depression. Can you talk to us a little bit about it?
Yeah, obviously burnout affects everything in with your body mentally and physically. And especially in America, the workforce we have now is very strict. And it used to be a lot of just the 40-hour weeks, but now we're working in cultures where people are there 60 to 80 hours a week, whether they're at the office or not. This expectation out there that you need to work and work and work and work and work, and you need to be better and better and better and better. And so it's going to affect us as human beings physically, emotionally, and as employers, as leaders. It's important to recognize that we're all human beings and we need to create an expectation that all employees need their time to take care of themselves. And we as leaders, same thing. There are a lot of amazing leaders out there who go above and beyond, but at the detriment of their own health. And that becomes a problem because then they can't lead as effectively. They can't be who they really are if they're exhausted or if they're burnt out or if they get sick often. And so it's important for leaders and followers everybody to be able to take care of their own health and keep up with life and, you know, maybe even be on top of it. I feel like we're running really far behind. We never have enough time. We always have more to do than we actually can get done. And so reversing that, so we feel like I have extra time, I have extra energy. And I think that would make a huge difference if we could, obviously this is dreaming, but, you know, change that, the entire workforce culture in general.
So what I say to folks that might say, you know, it's all good, Jake, I got you, but I just don't have time nor luxury to stop or to slow down.
That I would just revert that to time management and again, evaluating. And I'm the kind of person too. I mean, I admit, I enjoy, especially if I'm in the groove, I enjoy just pushing through it and getting a lot done. But there's a lot of science out there showing how long, you know, we can go as far as stretches, how long our concentration can last and our focus and our effectiveness. And so I would just say, really evaluate what it is you're doing. If you are in the office 8 hours a day, let's say minimum for most people, what are you doing in that 8 hours? How much time are you spending on social media? How much time are you spending answering emails? How much time are you spending on your phone? Things like that, and really analyzing that and trying to make the most of what you can in the least amount of time possible, being efficient and effective at the same time.
So you hold a master in organizational psychology, and I would be curious to know and to get your feedback on the best traits that one leader can have to be very effective in his or her organization.
In my opinion, some of the top qualities I've recognized in leaders that I've personally had in my life and in general from studying and from understanding what other people are going through, some of the top ones would be more on the, I wouldn't say soft side, but more on the sympathetic side of personality. So compassionate, kind, patient, sympathetic, understanding, loving, forgiving. Those I feel will make a leader stand out among the rest. Let's just assume all leaders were very good at leading teams. They were very good at delegating. They were good at, you know, managing other people. If you made everybody out and you made only some of them, you know, extremely, I guess, skilled in some of these personality traits, they would definitely be levels above those other leaders. And I feel, you know, that brings more of the personal side and sensitive side of the leadership. And I feel that's crucial, especially, you know, as we've been mentioning mental health, we've burnout, family, you know, there's emergency, self-care, self-development, professional development. If you can have a leader like that, where you know that as a friend and as a leader, someone who actually really cares, they don't view you as a transaction. They don't view you as part of their responsibility or their role, or they don't view you as just someone they have to deal with at work. And you feel that relationship built outside of that, that makes a huge difference. So for me, those are some of the top qualities I would say. And then obviously other ones like being organized, being able to work well under pressure, being able to lead and take action, those really separate the good from the great, I feel.
So it's very interesting that you mentioned, because some of the folks that I actually worked for, some of my bosses would say, you know, I can't be your friend. I can't be too softy like you are, because then I cannot reprimand you when you're not doing good. What do you say to those folks?
You know, there needs to be some sort of professionalism, obviously, in that relationship. And when come time to reprimand or to fire a person on your team that you've been very kind to and patient and loving with, you can do that still in a loving, compassionate, patient way and motivate and inspire people instead of trying to, like, push them and force them and things like that. And it's the way you go about it that will make the difference.
So would you say that it's accurate to say that you want to be a friendly leader, but not be friends?
Yeah, I would say so. And even still, like, if you are a friend, then I don't think that's always a bad thing. A lot of leaders I've had, I feel like I'm friends with them. And even though it's been years and I left the company, I still feel like I'm friends with them. And I feel like I can trust them. And so I feel like that's important, too. When you have a friendship, it's maybe different inside the workplace than outside, and that's fine. But yeah, anyways, I was just going to throw that thought out there too with that.
So you believe that you can draw that fine line between being friends outside the work and being friendly within work environment?
I think that takes practice, and I think it has to be mastered at some point. I think excellent leaders can do that. Decent leaders would probably have a hard time with that. And obviously, it is going to be difficult to do. But if you could do that, I think that would be a prime situation.
So you mentioned empathy, and I would be curious to know, how does empathy really helps the leadership?
I think it just humanizes them and helps others know that they care and that they understand. And when you have the authoritative side, you know, sometimes it can be intimidating. It can be scary. You know, you feel like you owe that respect. And though you still do respect them, you understand that, you know, they aren't this robot or this item or this object that's commanding you. They're another human being. They've gone through what you've gone through. And even if they haven't, they understand, or they can try to understand. That just, again, I think that humanizes the leader and helps them rise above all the other leaders if they can do that.
And you do a lot of speaking, and I was wondering, how did you start your speaking practice?
Yeah, so I've done speaking since I was in high school. And it's interesting because in high school, I actually wanted to be a public speaker. My uncle was a public speaker. I went with him one night and I fell in love with it. I did acting and I'd done a lot of speaking at church. I was in Boy Scouts. I was in student council. I was on a speech team for a little while. So all of these things, I just fell in love with it. And when I saw that, I said, I want to be a speaker one day. And starting it last year, 2018, I decided I want to own my own practice after I got my master's degree. I want to consult, but I also love to speak. Let me look into what the speaking world is like professionally, like as a speaker only, instead of doing it in the corporate world. And so I just started to get to know some of the people that were doing it. The National Speakers Association has chapters all over. And so I went to the North Texas chapter here outside of Dallas and met some people who have been doing it for 20 plus years and some other people that were just starting like me, just trying to get advice, trying to kind of gauge the market. A lot of them obviously said you need to have your messaging down. If you can come out with a book, that would be awesome collateral for you as a speaker. And you have to start off doing a lot of free gigs. They also said it could take anywhere from 2 to 5 years for it to actually blow up. And yeah, for months, I was doing anything free I could do and just to get in front of people I was doing. And then I just started reaching out to associations, and then things started spreading by word of mouth and referral. And then I built a presence on LinkedIn and people started seeing what I was doing and started requesting. And it all just kind of dominoed from there.
And how easy was it to break into the speaking market for you?
I wouldn't say it's like close to impossible. I wouldn't even necessarily say it was like extremely difficult, but you definitely have to have the personality type where you're extremely resilient and you're going to get told no a lot and you're going to have to do a lot of work for free. You know, you're going to feel like you're failing. And it's going to feel lonely. One of the things people told me at the very beginning was the speaking business is a very lonely business. You know, you're doing this on your own and you have to figure out a lot on your own and you have to deal with a lot on your own. So, you know, as much as you can, try and be around others who may be doing the same thing or find your tribe or the people who support you, spend your time around them. And if you can build that resiliency and just push through it, then it's all worth it. It becomes such an amazing thing.
So the advice would be resilient, know your niche, I guess, right?
Your niche.
Mm-hmm, yep. Yeah. And then also find the right audience and support, right?
Yes.
So you've
that's what made a difference for me.
Mm-hmm. So you've gone through a lot of reinventions. And on this show, we talk about the importance of people being open to reinvention. What are your thoughts and why do you think it's so important to allow yourself to reinvent?
You know, when you ask that question, I just think of evolution in general. Like, as animals have adapted, insects have adapted, humans have adapted over time, whether it's to climate change, whether it's to just physical surroundings, whatever it may be, we've always had to adapt as living organisms. I think of that the same thing with anything that we're doing, with any development in our life. We always need to be adapting and transforming and changing all the time in order to progress. And, you know, it just goes to that saying, if you're not doing anything, then you're not changing and get the same result. So in order to become a better person, become a better leader, become more skilled in whatever it is, in your craft, whatever it is you're doing, in order to grow your business, you have to consistently be evaluating eliminating, readdressing, figuring out what it is you could do differently, transforming. And I just feel like that if you're not doing that, you aren't going to make it in any aspect of your life. In a relationship, if you're not trying to continually nurture it and improve it, figure out what you can do better, then it's going to remain the same or it's going to backtrack and get worse. So I definitely think it's crucial.
And what about the folks that say, you know, reinvention sounds great, but I'm afraid of failure or setbacks, and how can I move past that?
You know, nobody likes failure. Us as human beings, we're designed that way. We don't like failure. We don't like having the door closed on us, any of that. But you do have to build up, again, that resiliency. You have to build up that passion. You have to build up the understanding. So if someone has just started their own business, let's say they opened up a coffee shop and they feel like it's just not doing that well, but I'm too scared to do anything to change, or I don't want to try a new idea because it may fail. A lot of times we say that when we're already kind of failing, or we're not where we want to be yet. So worst case scenario is, you know, we're basically in the same spot. We don't progress, but it's better to try to open up doors and better to go for something and have the possibility of helping you improve. So yeah, I believe it obviously will take time to build up that mentality, but you only have one life to live, and you got to be able to take some risks and obviously analyze those the best you can, but you just got to go for it if you want to get places in your life.
You know, my next question is, do you believe that being cautious helps you lead better?
Yeah. Let me tell you, I'm extremely cautious. Like, I have been overly cautious, way too cautious in the past. And I think in being a leader, yes, there are times where being too cautious might hurt a team or might hurt an organization. You know, it could slow you down in a decision-making process, or it could make you miss deadlines or drag other teams down or hold things back from progressing. And again, going back to a leader that may need to fire an employee or needs to do a serious, difficult performance review with somebody or things like that, if they're too cautious, then it could take things the wrong way or could keep change from happening. So I feel like there definitely needs to be, and I wouldn't necessarily say risk, but there needs to be a little bit more action and offense involved in being a leader than just defensive. So I think it's a good characteristic in some ways, but you just have to be careful depending on the situation you're in.
But I think what you're saying to us, we got to strike a balance, right?
Right. I think as with anything, you definitely don't want to be on one polar end or on the other polar end. You want to try and be as balanced as you can. And yeah.
So how do you find that balance in a overproductive space that it's constantly requesting you to produce or to make decisions?
It goes back to that evaluating. So whether it's, you end up doing a 360 assessment, you end up doing a strength finders assessment, you end up doing a time management assessment out there, just evaluating consistently where you are, what you're accomplishing, how others view you as a leader, and figuring out what it is you can do better, and always coming back to that and reassessing, altering it. And I think you would label that under mindfulness or emotional intelligence, and always trying to be aware of how you're impacting everybody else and if you're reaching your potential and expectations or not. And that's what I would say. In the crazy world we live in, if a leader is emotionally intelligent and they're practicing mindfulness, they're going to also stand out as a leader amongst the rest.
And just so we are, for the folks that are not familiar with 360, can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Yeah, it's an assessment that is made between, I guess you could say, employee and manager or leader and those on the team. And it's an assessment that gathers data and information based on how the employee feels and based on what the leader sees and feels, and kind of turns it around. That way they can see from all angles how they are performing as a leader, what they can improve on, and what they're doing well on. And obviously taking that assessment frequently will allow you to again, gather that feedback from everybody on how you're doing.
Talking about feedback, how do you evaluate your own success?
For me, what I have to do is step out of myself. I am extremely difficult on myself. I have very high expectations for myself. I'm a perfectionist in a lot of ways. And, you know, if I don't do something right, or I don't perform well, or if I mess something up, I crush myself for that. And so when I take this time to evaluate how am I doing, what am I getting done, how am I impacting and influencing others, how are they viewing me, I have to step out almost as a third person and view me, Jake, as somebody else. And as much as I can, let go of that first person thoughts and ideas and try and evaluate it that way.
Mm-hmm. So how do you quiet or soothe that critical mind?
Oh, that's a good question. I think, again, it's stepping outside of myself and trying to understand that as a human being, we make mistakes. And in order to grow, we have to fail and we have to mess up. And, you know, that gives us the opportunity to learn from it. And trying not to be so hard on yourself, it's just turning the mindset around to, I'm not doing this well, I can't do this, to, hey, I did a great job, I'm doing awesome. And, you know, just changing the negative to positives, at least for me, that's what I've had to do.
So it's almost kind of being kinder to yourself, right?
Yeah, mm-hmm. Absolutely. Treating ourselves with more respect and kindness.
Mm-hmm. Any thoughts on generosity and leadership?
I believe in generosity in anything we do in life. You know, whether it's giving time, whether it's giving money, whether it's giving love, whether it's giving energy, whatever it may be, you know, I feel like all of us, whether we're in a leadership position or not, have the capacity to give something to others in need. And a generous leader is going to rise above and stand out above all other leaders. And that is a characteristic or trait that is invaluable, I believe, as a leader. When people know that you're the type of person that's willing to give more than receive and give, maybe even if they don't have very much, if they're still willing to give and they want to do that for the benefit of other people to help, that will never be forgotten. I feel like that's a legendary characteristic in a leader.
And, you know, I really like that you talk about giving. And sometimes as leaders, we give and give and give and there is nothing left for us. So how do you set that boundaries, you know, in giving and then also having that boundary to a little bit keep for yourself so that you have an engine to keep on going?
That actually goes back to the program that I have available with my world-class leader and things that I speak on. It's if our cup is not full, we cannot start filling up the cups of others. Or if we aren't providing ourselves oxygen, we cannot provide others with oxygen and, you know, put the masks on others. So it's crucial for us at any given time to understand that we have to take care of ourselves before we can take care of others. And yes, a generous person, an unselfish person is always going to want to give first, but it never plays out well to those that give everything they have and, you know, can't fend for themselves. And, you know, if you think about a millionaire, let's say they have $1 million and they see all these people who need help, they give every dollar away. Well, guess what? They're living on the street, you know, so you have to be cautious in how your giving is, like you said, and making sure that you are providing for yourself, you're providing for your family in whatever way needed, and you're growing and progressing as a professional, and then making sure you're giving after that.
So what strategies you might give to folks that might have trouble setting up boundaries?
I would say just doing personal assessments, easy things like assessing every day what your stress levels are, how happy you are on a scale of 1 to 10, how productive you are on a scale of 1 to 10. If you're absolutely stressed out of your mind every day, like on a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being extremely stressed, 1 being not stressed at all or feeling very little stress, and you're like an 7, 8, 9, 10 all the time, then there definitely needs to be a line drawn where you're giving, whether it's you're giving responsibilities to other people, or you're delegating work off to somebody else, or you know, you're not spending the extra time trying to help your team after work because that puts you behind or it makes your family get upset that you're not home in time. You just have to assess your stress, your happiness, again, your productivity, your satisfaction in life. And if any of those things are hurting at all, then you have to judge and assess what it is that's causing that and then draw the lines and boundaries there, pull back, take care of yourself, and then keep moving forward.
So what you're saying to us, assess and eliminate the stressors.
Yep. Evaluate and eliminate. Mm-hmm. Those are two E's I love to share almost in all the methods that I use. Evaluate and then eliminate whatever it is that's holding you back.
And I guess if you're not good at it, you can always get a coach.
You can. And that's actually the world we live in today. There are so many coaches out there in the world today. I mean, anything from fitness and health and wellness to business, leadership, executive, and everything in between, finance. I truly believe it's no weakness to have a coach. And we should be proud that we're reaching out and asking for help to improve ourselves. I don't think it shows any weakness in any of us if we were to hire a personal coach or a business coach. I think it's a wise investment to make as a leader.
And I would assume that as a coach, you at one point also had a coach, right?
Yes. Yes, I do, actually. I have a coach coaching me on how to become a better coach. And it's invaluable. I've been leaps and bounds above where I would have been without her. And her name's Lauren Trillin. I'll just throw it out there. And she's been an amazing mentor and coach to me. And she's extremely successful in what she does. And yeah, even coaches need coaches.
And if someone has never had a coach and kind of wondered how many sessions one needs to have to achieve a particular goal, what would you say to them?
You know, there's a lot of research done on how long it takes to build a habit, but I believe around the 8-week mark is when you cross that point where you've been able to build and adjust new habit. And so I would say anything less than 8 weeks is not enough time for you to make changes and adjustments in your life. And so I would say anywhere between 8 weeks and 6 months is a good time frame for how long you should be in a coaching program. And obviously, if you can afford it and you're getting results and you're getting the accountability and everything you're expecting out of it, then doing it even more consistently and extending it's awesome. But I would definitely say 8 weeks minimum, and anywhere between, you know, 4 to 6 months is a good time frame.
And how do you know if your coach is a perfect coach for you? What would be the indications?
You know, that's a great question. I have a lot of friends that have hired coaches that got them nowhere, but ended up not following through on what they, you know, said they offered. And a lot of people felt like they wasted a lot of money. So, you know, there's certain characteristics you need to look for in a coach. You need to make sure that they're organized. You need to make sure that they obviously have a track record, a good track record. You need to make sure that they're going to hold you accountable. Obviously, there's some coaches out there that want to tell people everything they should do, but a good coach is going to be there to help mentor you and guide you, not tell you everything you need to be doing, but help you figure it out for yourself, and making sure that the service that the coach is offering, that it's detailed for you. So you know exactly what you're going to be covering, you know how long you're going to be covering it, and you know what the potential outcome is if you do what they tell you to do. If a coach isn't providing any of that to you or only some of that, then I would definitely research and try and find a coach that is all of those things and provides all of those things. So it's worth your money and your investment.
So some coaches are sort of an open-ended type of coaches. Would you say that these coaches are not very effective?
I feel like there needs to be a foundation set. When people are investing money, typically coaches will have a program, and that's what people will purchase. There needs to be a baseline or a foundation there where people can understand from a high level what it is they're going to get. It doesn't need to be detailed as in, you know, for our one call this week, we're going over this and this, but just a high level view of what they're going to be getting out of it. And I do believe in teaching to the needs and being open and adjusting. I have a client of mine who hired me to help her organize her home and her life. And the last couple of weeks, she decided, hey, Jake, I actually want you to help me with my marketing materials. So I adjusted that on the fly, and we were able to run with it and meet her needs. So I absolutely believe in being open-ended, but you do have to have, again, that baseline and foundation set so that people know what they're buying.
So what would be your coaching style like?
I would say mine would be more transformational. So being there to obviously help guide them and direct them, but my goal is to help them come in as one person and leave as a different person, whether their skills have developed, whether their mindset has developed. The entire process is a transformation, and I work from taking them from where they are to where they want to be and transforming them into that future person, or taking them to the future state that they want to arrive in, and using methodology or concepts or tools to help them in that transformation process, and empowering them, making sure that I'm not telling them exactly what to do and I'm not doing it for them, but I'm there as an accountability partner, and I'm there as a mentor and a guide to help them figure it out. So that way, you know, when our time comes to an end in working together, they've been able to develop that self-sufficiency and take on that responsibility to be able to do it on their own and flourish without somebody there telling them what to do all the time. So that's my approach to how I coach.
And what is your leadership style like?
It would also be transformational, or it would be with coaching. So as a leader, I definitely am more, and that probably is because I am a coach, but being there to help, again, guide, lead, and mentor. And with the transformational, same thing, helping if I'm managing a team or if I'm leading an organization, whatever it is, helping them, again, go from one spot to another and using any sort of tactics or strategies, help them develop any traits they can to make that transformation in their lives. I would probably say I'm a mix between those two.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned coaching and helping people develop towards their best selves. So my next question is, what are your thoughts on clarity and curiosity and how that impacts leadership practice?
My great-grandfather always told me that the greatest trait a human being can have is to be curious. And he always talked to me about it. He was one of the most intelligent people I've ever heard of. And he always said that he admired that most about little kids, is that they were always so curious. And that's why, you know, as little kids, we're able to absorb so much and we're able to learn so quickly. It's because we're curious. And as we get older, we start getting comfortable and we stop asking questions. And, you know, we start fearing judgment of feeling dumb or, you know, not knowing the answer to something or not knowing how to do something. And so I am definitely a believer that curiosity as a leader and, you know, helping your team develop that skill of practicing curiosity is very important. And clarity as well. If you don't know where you're going as a leader, you don't know where you're taking your team, and your teammates do not know where they are going, you're running off into the woods and not exactly sure where you're going to end up. But by being clear on purpose, on mission, clear on rules, clear on expectations, clear in communication, that's obviously going to put your team leagues above others, and that's going to spread and help the entire organization. So I believe both of them are absolutely crucial to becoming an outstanding leader.
And do you think that if you're not clear, you should engage your team to help you out?
Absolutely. And I think it's the entire team's responsibility. If the leader's clear and the team isn't, there's an issue. And if the team's clear and the leader isn't, then there's an issue. So it's definitely a collective team effort. And yeah, if you as a leader aren't exactly sure, then gather the feedback of the team and try and get on the same page and work together as one the best you can.
And how do you mention being on the same page? And I work for an organization where folks were not communicating nor being on the same page. How to ensure that everyone is on the same page?
You know, it's consistently communicating and communicating effectively, making sure people are actually voicing their opinions, people are actually voicing how they feel, voicing their ideas. If you have three people on a team of five that don't speak up, then when a decision comes to be made, it's basically, you know, going to be the vote of two people. That's where you're going to take all your ideas and that's where you're going to get the energy from. So it's everybody's responsibility to speak up when it's needed. And there's going to have to be compromise involved. Not everybody's going to want the same thing. And I've been on teams where every single one of us wants something totally different. And, you know, there has to be a compromise and a willingness to compromise for there to be clarity agreed upon by everybody.
So interesting word compromise. It's very interesting to me because when we all have a different agenda, how do you compromise?
That's a good question. I think compromising is definitely a skill itself. And, you know, as a leader, that's going to be the heaviest of responsibility for you as a leader. And I think it comes to a point where you have to, again, evaluate what's going to be best for the team. So if it comes down to, you know, 75% of a team wants to go one way, 25% wants to go another, how do you compromise that, especially if they're in opposite directions? It's, again, just trying to evaluate what's going to be best for the team and what's best for the organization or best for whatever it is. Even if you're a sports team, the coach is the one that ultimately makes the decision on what's best for the team and how they should play. And for instance, bringing it to basketball, if the basketball team is playing another team and the coach feels that playing a zone defense is better than a man-to-man defense, but the players disagree, it's ultimately the coach's call on what defense those players should be playing. And I believe that's the same way in the workplace.
That's very interesting analogy. So obviously to compromise, you have to have respect for everyone. And I know that you have given a talk on that. So I was wondering if you can tell us why having respect for everyone is so crucial in the workplace.
You know, respect is sadly not as prominent in our society as I feel it used to be. And that's due to culture. Some people think it's due to generations. It's due to a lot of different things. But I think there are two things I feel like we all deserve as human beings. One is love, and two is respect. And when I have spoken on respect and I've tried to help others apply this and become, you know, more respectful of those around them, I try and tell them that respect doesn't mean you have to like what they say. It doesn't mean you have to agree with the person. Respect just means you understand they have their position and that's okay. And you understand that even if it is different than yours, they have that right to have a different opinion or a different idea or a different desire. And so that's what respect is. It doesn't mean you agree, and it doesn't mean you have to like what they say or do. It just means that you respect their freedom to have their own opinion and make their own choices.
You know, I'm really curious to actually talk more about this, because nowadays people are very reactive. And I think when you're reactive, you sort of ruin that sense of respect for another person. How do you change that within, you know, because obviously people are just so reactive that even we have on that on the Twitter all the time, that people jump to, you know, conclusions and just react very badly. And that spins off into really crazy. So what are your thoughts on that?
Oh boy, you know, majority of our society just needs to understand the emotional intelligence, and they need to understand how to manage their own attitudes. They need to have better self-control. And yeah, I think there is a lot of especially emotional reaction going on, and a lot of that happens on social media. But I feel like you have to understand what respect is and understand that you have to have respect for other human beings. And by understanding that, you're going to react differently. And I feel like maybe that's perhaps a reason why so many react so quickly and strongly and wrongly at the same time, is because they lack that concept of respect. Whereas if you understand what respect is, you're going to start treating people and reacting much differently.
So that leads me to my next question, which is, do you believe that understanding that we are all equal to one another helps you respect people better?
Absolutely. We are all equal. And sometimes it can get hard, especially, you know, if you go into the workplace and you have the CEO of a company and you're at the very low end, you're always going to feel like they're better than you. But you have to realize when you walk out of the doors of the workplace, they're a human being just like you are. And though you have to, you know, give them the respect and you have to listen to what it is they want you to do in the business or the company, that they are still a human being. And yeah, by understanding that no one is better than others, which is also lacking in our society. There's a lot of people that think they're better than others, or groups or whatever it is that think they're better than the others out there. That's where a lot of our problems come. And that's why there's not as much love out there in the world. There's not as much peace out there in the world, because that respect and understanding that we're all one and we should be is not as strong as it should be.
So everything is boiled down to power, and folks that don't have respect for others have this power over approach. What are your thoughts on that?
You know, I'm thinking of authority and power. And power, even looking back in the history of the world, power has caused people to do some of the worst things comparable to man. But it has also caused some people to be able to do the best things with it and make some of the best changes in history possible. So having power isn't necessarily a bad thing, or having authority isn't a bad thing. It's just what you do with that power that will make or break it. And I guess I would relate it to money or wealth. You know, if you have accumulated a lot of wealth or a lot of money, there's a lot of really good things you can do with it. And there's a lot of really bad things you can do with it. And so it's all dependent on the beholder or the person who is in control, and what they do with it is going to make or break, you know, what they've been given. And it's a responsibility to understand how to use it.
So do you believe that positive implementation of power can change the world or impact people in 20 seconds or less?
Here's my opinion. I don't believe you can change a life in 20 seconds. I believe you can save a life in 20 seconds, influence a life in 20 seconds. So for me, obviously, if I were to get up and do a one-hour keynote, at the end of that 1 hour, I need to understand that I probably didn't change lives, but I did influence them, which will ultimately change lives. So, you know, in that 20 seconds as a leader, you don't necessarily change the life right there, but you are a part of that change of life, if that makes sense. That's my opinion.
That's very interesting. So how do you stay humble while leading others?
I think it goes back to the power question too, because power can certainly get to your head, and the authority can get to your head, and the command and the responsibility and things like that. But it goes back to understanding how to use that the best you can. And what I've really learned, and this is what I try to tell every leader out there, whether they're the top leader in a huge Fortune 100 company, or they're the owner of a small business, or they're a parent or a teacher or a sports coach, whatever it is, it's understanding that their role as a leader is just as much of a learning experience for them as it is for the people that they're leading. And I believe as a leader, it's an even greater blessing for you to be able to lead than for those people to have you as a leader, because it's going to be an opportunity again for you to grow and develop more than you would have not being a leader. And so I believe also a lot of people that are put into leadership positions are those that have more to work on and have more to grow in and have much more potential to rise up to. And that's the responsibility a leader has.
So what you're saying to us, it's a learning experience.
It is, 100%. Mm-hmm. And it always will be. You know, there are ideas out there that when you become a leader, that means you've made it, and you're at the top and you're the best. And I don't believe that at all. I feel like that a leader is only as good as their team or their followers. And if you do not have a following, you're not going to be an effective leader or an influencer. And if you don't have a team that's behind you, you're not going to be an effective leader. It's just not going to happen.
So it's a collaboration, what you're saying to us. It's a teamwork.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. The leader is just one that has a different responsibility and maybe more control with voice or direction, but that's it. It's a team effort, and everybody's equal on the team. The leader, again, just has a different responsibility.
Mm-hmm. And that is why respect is so important.
Right, exactly.
Mm-hmm. Any thoughts for women leaders?
Women leaders are better than men leaders. I was raised that way, and I've always believed that men have so much to live up to women. Women are mothers, women are wives, women are sisters, aunts, friends, and I believe women have traits and abilities that men don't necessarily have, and I'm grateful that we're living in a world where women are able to be in higher leadership positions than they used to be, and I think it's well-deserved. And I think the men have a lot to learn from women. I don't know, some people may disagree, but I strongly believe that.
And what is your mission in life?
My mission in life is to, whatever way possible, it's to be able to lift others. And that's why I'm doing what I'm doing, because I'm trying to do that on a larger scale by getting up in front of audiences and by, you know, trying to influence on social media and things like that. I can expand my reach. But ultimately, if I was able to help lift one person a day or one person a year, whatever it is, that's me fulfilling my purpose and my mission in life.
Any final thoughts?
I think you asked amazing questions, and I think you got a lot of wheels turning in my head tonight, so I appreciate that. I think we talked about things that this audience and leaders out there absolutely need to hear, and not just because you and I talked about it, but because we've recognized that these are issues out there, and we all have room to improve. So I guess my final thoughts would be thank you for putting this together and for the questions that you compiled.
Thank you. And how can people contact you or learn about what you do? Or come to your talks?
Yeah, sure. So the best place is on my website. It's www.jakebmelton.com. jakebmelton.com. You can also find me on LinkedIn. I'm very active on LinkedIn, just at Jake Melton. Connect with me there. I'm also on Instagram, Jake Melton B, and on Facebook, Jake Melton, and Twitter, Jake Melton. So you can reach me on basically any social media platform, but go to my website or LinkedIn if you absolutely want to get a hold of me. And as far as getting a hold of my book, you can find that on Amazon. Again, Minimalize to Maximize Your Happiness, Cut the Crap. There's also a workbook edition that was released a few months back, which I highly recommend even over the original. So definitely check it out on Amazon if that's something you're looking into.
And there's also a Kindle version, right?
Yep, there is. There is a Kindle version available.
So again, the website is?
JakeBMelton.com.
Thank you so much, Jake, for being a guest.
Oh, thank you so much for having me. It was a great time.
Thanks. Our special guest was Jake Melton, speaker, author, and a coach. And with that, thank you for tuning in and listening to the Leadership with Biana Kovic show. Please remember that you're all leaders in your own right, and that the impact that you're meant to achieve starts with small acts of kindness, curiosity, and generosity. If you like the show, please follow me on Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn, or Instagram. You can also listen to the past episodes and subscribe to my Leadership with Biana Kovic YouTube channel. I wish you a wonderful evening. Until next time, thank you again and have a great night.
Different breed.